This episode is a special one that was voted on by my Patreon supporters. Thank you so much for believing in me and allowing me to chase a dream. Thank you. The Super Nintendo was a magical system that allowed companies to create worlds that allowed you to explore, meet amazing friends, and conquer unspeakable evils to save humanity as we know it. While it might be a general plot, the Chrono series managed to hit the ground running to make amazing memories for us, not only on the Super Nintendo, but the PlayStation as well. Is the series worth it? Well, stick around and I'll tell you. My name is Fortifier, and welcome to Series Slayer. Growing up, I didn't tend to play RPGs, mostly because I didn't know what they were. I guess in some ways, the first RPG I ever played was Kingdom Hearts, but I didn't approach it like an RPG, instead approaching it like an action-adventure game. It wasn't until I played Dragon Age Origins where I realized exactly what a RPG was. Looking back, I had played tons of them, and I never knew what they were. Secret of Mana, Illusion of Gaia, Soul Blazer, and Chrono Trigger. Which is what we're talking about today. Hands down, one of the greatest games ever created, Chrono Trigger, and the other games that followed it. That being said, I am not going to hold back on story. I've taken the time to complete these games to their entirety, and as such, there will be spoilers. So if you're sensitive to that, I would suggest avoiding this episode until you've taken the time to play them. If you're still here, I'm assuming you have. So let's begin. The first game in the Chrono series was Chrono Trigger, and it was released in 1995 on the Super Famicom and the Super Nintendo. It was created by a group of phenomenal pioneers in the JRPG world. Hironobu Sakaguchi, who was well known for Final Fantasy, Yuji Horii, who already saw success with the Dragon Quest franchise, and Akira Toriyama, who was well known at the time for being the author of the Dragon Ball anime. All three of these guys took their specific abilities and funneled it straight into the 117.75 megabits of ROM data allowed on a Super Nintendo cart and created what is easily known as one of the best games of all time. Usually, I argue that superlative, but when it comes to Chrono Trigger, there is no argument. Between Chrono Trigger and Final Fantasy VI, I personally cannot decide which is better, because they're golden standards on the Super Nintendo. The story is dynamic, but it starts off simple. The setting is 1000 AD and Chrono, our main character, is woken up by his mom so that they can attend the Millennium Fair. Along the way, we bump into another supplementary character, Marl, and within a few dialogue options, we have a friend. Marl and Chrono visit another one of Chrono's friends, Luca, who belongs to a family of inventive scientists, where she's showcasing her teleportation device. Luca requests a volunteer and Marl gladly steps into the platform, but suddenly a pendant that she's wearing causes a time disruption. And everyone is sucked into the portal and brought to the forest grove, where Chrono realizes that they've been teleported 400 years to the past. Now, the key aspect of this game is time travel, and the ultimate bad guy is Lavos, who, according to a prophecy, will destroy the world in 1999, so we logically need to avoid that. We do that by traveling to various time periods, and within each of these little eras, a major plot point traditionally occurs, usually resulting in an addition of another character to our party. Throughout our journeys, we make decisions that can affect the allies that we receive, such as Magus, and the overall landscape of the world as we know it. We go back to the prehistoric times, medieval kingdoms, and a desolate future with unique and charming characters. The most important part of this game is that our decisions do matter, and they culminate to rewriting history by defeating Lavos while contending with plot twists, betrayals, and heartfelt moments that make this game an absolute treasure and 100% worth the price point that it carries. At no point during Chrono Trigger did I feel lost. At no point did I lose interest. This game has captivating music, a cast of lovable characters that form a truly diverse team. And if you don't want to dump the cash for a SNES copy of the game, it was released on a few other mediums. There was a PlayStation version known as Final Fantasy Chronicles, where it was paired with Final Fantasy IV, but I don't suggest playing it because Tosei, or whatever their name is, did a wonderful job of making sure that the load times were monotonous and that it interrupted gameplay. It's horrible. They also released a DS port, but I've never played it, so I can't vouch for it. Finally, it was released on Steam, on phone, on PlayStation Network. It's popular, it deserves it. Between the music, the storyline progression, the actual combat mechanics, and the artwork, there's nothing I can possibly complain about when it comes to this game. After the success of Chrono Trigger, Square was oddly quiet about it. was kind of disheartening. Such a legacy game surely had another entry on the way, right? Well, no. Instead, Square opted for a visual novel on the Satellaview known as Radical Dreamers. In some ways it was a spin-off, but in many ways it was a strange cousin of Chrono Trigger. Now, before we get into that, I do want to explain what the Satellaview was, because in execution, it's actually quite interesting. The Satellaview was the result of a joint venture between Nintendo and Saint Giga, who at the time was suffering financially in the satellite radio market. That's what the Satellaview did. It was a satellite game expansion for the Super Famicom, and it would allow children to play games in timed blocks. The games that tend to come to mind are the BS Zelda games, where BS stands for Broadcast Satellite and not Bullshit, where the narrator says, "I have limited power, so my power will fail in an hour." And in understanding that principle, storylines were written for consumers. Radical Dreamers was a text adventure that was originally broadcasted on February 3rd, 1996, which was a single broadcast in comparison to, say, The Legend of Zelda, which was broadcast on four different days, at least from the information that I could find. The whole story revolves around Sergei, Kid, and McGill, who are thieves searching for the Frozen Flame. They know that it's hidden in a mansion known as Viper Mansion, which is owned by a horrible asshole named Lynx, who usurped power by totally killing these legendary warriors of time, Acacia Dragoons. After breaking into the manor, they encounter tons of enemies and learn lore about how the Frozen Flame is actually a piece of a parasitic monster known as Lavos, which broke off when he embedded himself in the planet's core. Now, this is a direct reference to Chrono Trigger, as Lavos is the final boss of the game. Then the group goes to the Kingdom of Zeal, at least to the ruins of it, to find the Frozen Flame, during which we learn that Kid was in an orphanage led by someone named Luca. So in many ways, we have direct correlations with Chrono Trigger, with a unique story, albeit kind of broken. The game itself is quite simple, and all of these decisions are made through a text pathway, because it's a visual novel, you know? And from a story perspective, I didn't really find it that bad. It's just a shame that the rest of the world would never see it until 26 years later, when it was bundled with something else. Chrono Cross. Chrono Cross was an anomaly, because for many people that never experienced Radical Dreamers, myself included, the story was incredibly obtuse and hard to keep track of. In many ways, Chrono Cross was the result of managers at Square wanting a new Chrono game. They appointed Hiromichi Tanaka as the producer, and also brought in Masato Kato to make a game in the spirit of Radical Dreamers, but Kato felt that Radical Dreamers was an incomplete story, which for all intents and purposes, it was. It was a truncated small scenario that just managed to kind of link the game to Trigger, but it really didn't impact much of the story outside of a few cameos to the past lore. So Tanaka and Kato decided to straight up create an indirect sequel, incorporating some, if not all, of Radical Dreamers, and adapting it to what would be known as Chrono Cross. But there were some things that they wanted to do a little bit differently. For starters, they didn't want time travel to be an element, because they felt that it would be too similar to Chrono Trigger, but at the same time, they didn't want to deviate too far from what made Chrono Trigger amazing. Instead, they decided to carry over a basic combat system and kind of spice it up a little bit. Also incorporate the core tenets of the Radical Dreamer story while creating a magical world that revolves around alternate dimensions. Now, the story of Chrono Cross is an absolute nightmare for me to explain, so I'll try my best from what I recall in playing it. The game itself was incredibly forgettable to me, and because at the end of the day, the only thing that I truly enjoyed about it was the music, straight up, just the music. Okay, here we go. Our story begins with us playing as Sergei in El Nido, which is a tropical area where most people are demi-humans, that is to say, anthropomorphic representations of human-animal hybrids. Soon after the start of the game, we slip into an alternate dimension. Now, in this alternate dimension known as Another World, our character drowned 10 years ago. This is also the dimension where we meet Kid, who is again from Radical Dreamers, and we work with Kid to steal something called the Frozen Flame from Viper Manor. Is it all making sense now? They did take a lot from Radical Dreamers, and it serves as like a majority of the plot point. Bouncing between Another World and Homeworld, we meet tons of friends, many of which can become playable teammates, and at one time, we even run into a guy named Fate, a being protecting the Dead Sea. After we kill him, we see Chrono, Marl, and Luca, explaining that Sergei's existence dooms Homeworld to being affected by Lavos, which made no sense to me. Following the story was an absolute nightmare. And I didn't like how they represented Chrono, Marl, and Luca. They made them seem like snot-nosed teenagers, which isn't true. They were awesome in Chrono Trigger. And honestly, to try to explain anything further about the plot would just be me reading Wikipedia, because I don't remember anything from that point on. So I'm not going to subject you all to that. If you want a generalized plot, go to Google, type in, you know, spoiler-free synopsis. That's the best thing for you to do, because I'm not going to do it here today. I will say that after the Fate incident, the game just drags on. You'll be looking for something called a time egg, you'll be fighting clones, you'll be freeing people from Lavos, you'll be switching bodies with Lynx and playing as him for, like, far longer than you should. It really doesn't make any sense unless you are truly mentally invested in the storyline. Now, in terms of combat, they incorporated this color-based affinity or innate elemental aspect that, in my opinion, is kind of like rock, paper, scissors, right? Sergei is a white elemental, which means all of his attacks are holy. Lynx is black, which is darkness. Kids are red. You have some people who are blue, which is water. You know, you get the picture. White and black oppose each other in terms of effectivity. Red and blue do as well. And finally, yellow and green, with yellow being lightning and green being earth. Makes sense? Now, in theory, these attacks would work against each other, but I swear that during the entirety of my gameplay, it didn't matter at all. Like, at all. It was just another RPG to me. Also, when you use a colored move, it changes the field, which is that thing in the top left. And when you have three colors of a field, that color is supposed to be super powerful. But again, I didn't feel like it worked at all. Oh, and there's 45 playable characters. That's awesome, right? No, it's not, because you can't level them up. The developers of Chrono Cross totally yanked XP in favor of star points. What is that? It means that when you beat a boss, you get a star level, or star points, or star bullshit, whatever it's called, and then, and only then, do you get new moves. So if you want to have a wide variety of playable characters, so that you can, like, do damage and have a diverse team, tough shit. You're just gonna have to rock with the team you choose, because you're never gonna be able to level them up. But I guess it offers some replayability, so yay for that. The problem I have with this game is that by the time I was done with it, I was done with it, like mentally just done with it. The true ending is also incredibly cryptic to get, so I said screw it and took the subpar normal ending and wished that I was playing Chrono Trigger. So that begs the question, is the Chrono series worth it? I don't believe that it is. I don't think the overall franchise is something that you should make a point to check out, because I would have honestly preferred to not even know that Chrono Cross exists. Chrono Trigger was a force to be reckoned with by Square. And then Chrono Cross just felt like it fell short in comparison to other RPGs that Square was pumping out at the time, such as Final Fantasy VII, VIII, IX, or even Xenogears, maybe even Parasite Eve. And that's sad, because they missed out on a really dope opportunity to continue a legendary storyline. I never really considered that they painted themselves into a corner lore-wise, but they sure did after Cross was released. Now, this particular video was a Patreon request, as I mentioned before, and if you do wish to vote on episodes like this, then feel free to join my Patreon. The link is down below. If you don't mind, hit that like button, because it does help with the visibility, and in the comments, feel free to tell me about your thoughts on Chrono Cross, because I am tremendously interested. As always, from my family to your family, good energy, good vibes, Fortifier out.